On this episode of the 2020 Awards podcast, we're going to be talking about music. No, not that kind of music. Music from the movie Patton.
Tell me, General, what do you think of Morocco?
I love it, Excellency. It's a combination of the Bible and Hollywood.
Our guest today is composer Erik Aho. He currently has a documentary playing at the Seattle International Film Festival entitled Oil and Water. The film screens on June 3rd at 7 p.m. and June 4th at 4:15 p.m. Both screenings will be at the AMC Pacific Place 11. Erik has composed for film, television, and video games. Some of his credits include The Amazing Race, The Bachelor, and orchestrating for The Family Guy. In the summer of 2013, Erik was invited to attend ASCAP's prestigious Film and Television Composers Workshop and became the 2013 recipient of the ASCAP Foundation's David Rose Award. He was also chosen by over 60 musicians from the Hollywood film scoring community to receive the 2013 RMALA grant, and his greatest professional experience was composing the score for the movie Inheritance. Wow, that's so great, because I directed that, so that's...
Amazing film, amazing.
I didn't realize that was your biggest professional Mount Everest. Wow, that's good. Erik, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Kris.
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you, too.
I haven't seen you, I don't know how long.
It's been years.
You had a kid, and you got married since I saw you last.
That's correct.
That's weird.
And I got a dog, too.
See, now that's... What kind of dog?
Lab mix, black, a little bit of shepherd.
We'll post a photo maybe to the website.
Fantastic.
So, tell me about Oil and Water.
Oil and Water is the story of two kids against the backdrop of the oil lawsuits that have been going on in Ecuador for 20 years now. In the 60s and 70s, Chevron went into the Amazon and extracted a bunch of oil. Left the an environmental disaster, open pits of chemicals, open pits of oil, and the native people there, the Kofun Indians, have had incredible incidence of things like cancer, skin disease, and these lawsuits that started in the 90s have been going on for 20 years. Anyway, against the backdrop of that, it's a 23-year-old student from the University of Washington that went down to this Kofun village and was asked by the leader of the tribe to take home his son to Seattle, Washington, in order to educate his 10-year-old son so mm-hmm. he could come back and lead the tribe and help the tribe fight the oil companies. Right. While they're exploring that backstory, they discover another boy. At age 14, he gets involved in the lawsuit and ends up working on it, becoming an invaluable member at age 14 of the lawyer's right. team, becomes very passionate about it. So at age 15, I think his mom sends him down to Ecuador to stay with the family down there and find out more about the situation. So that the movie's the story of these two kids and how they meet and how they kind of end up working together a little bit.
Right.
To confront this issue.
So it's basically two cultures exchanging.
Right. So you have the American kid going down to Ecuador, you have the Ecuador kid coming up to America, and yeah, it's kind of this reversal. Interesting cross-cultural thing.
That's pretty cool. And the filmmakers are
Francine Strickverda
mm-hmm.
and Laurel Spellman Smith.
Okay.
And they've been working on this a long time. I think they've been working on this for 8 years. Yeah. And yeah.
And how'd you get involved?
I got involved. I scored their last movie, which was called Busting Out.
Right.
And so they asked me to do this one.
Okay. When you're doing this, are you scoring from the different perspectives of these kids, or what was your tack on that?
Most of it takes place in Ecuador, and even when they're in Seattle, they're talking about Ecuador and Hugo's background. Even when David goes back to Colombia, it still kind of feels like his heart is in Ecuador and Latin America. So I approached the score kind of instrumentally. So I basically used Ecuadorian, mostly Andean instruments, even though it takes place in the in the rainforest and used them non-traditionally. Mm-hmm. So kind of played, you know, created kind of textures and backgrounds with them.
Do you have like a different approach to doing something that's a documentary versus a more of a traditional narrative?
I find documentaries more challenging just because there's a fair amount of talking heads, especially if you're doing background and explaining a subject that requires explaining, like right. the oil lawsuit,
yeah.
like the history of the Kofun people. So to me, it's a bit of a challenge because it's different than dramatic scoring. You're dealing with people talking, you know what right. I mean? And that's right. always... that's always difficult because you don't know, you don't want it to be melodramatic.
Sure.
You don't want it to be, you know, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and you don't want to get in the way of the voiceover.
Right, right. A lot of the television stuff, like Amazing Race, certainly. Like, what, how is that? That's more of a library though, right? Don't you guys just kind
of... That's more of a library. So yeah. when I was working on that show, we'd create a library of, and there were maybe five different categories of... You've seen that show, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
it's action, and a little bit more action with a little triumph at the end. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right,
so
right,
they're basically
yeah.
all, you're creating these, you know, action cues, and you're creating the super action cues, and then you're creating the triumph thing at the end. And so that's where it all kind of fell into. And so when I was working on that show, it was, you create a custom library for each season, and then they yeah. use cues also from the past season.
Right.
Seasons to kind of, you know... keep the brand cohesive, and they have, you know, they have their favorite cues.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But with that, I mean, I would imagine there must be some nice training in that. That show goes all over the world. There's like a, it's, I don't watch the show religiously, but like when I do, is like, it seems like there's a little bit of like, you know, international flavor to it.
That, yeah. I mean, yeah. when they go to the desert, you get to do something with, you know, big percussion and droney things.
Right.
When they go, I remember there was, they went to Brazil. I went to Rio de Janeiro one season. And that was really fun because you get to use Carlos Jobim harmonies. Mm. You know what I mean? You get to play bossa nova, you get to play samba, and you're using jazz chords that you never, outside of that context, you'd never be able
yeah,
to use,
yeah.
you know? So that's, you know, that was fun.
Right. Well, speaking of the desert, shall we, get into Patton?
Let's get into Patton.
So Patton was released in 1970. It was directed by Franklin J. Schaffner with a score by Jerry Goldsmith. For those who haven't seen it, Patton is the biography of World War II General George S. Patton. The film follows his journey as a tough-as-nails leader who eventually is forced into retirement for being too hard on his troops. The film received 10 Academy Award nominations, including Best Score. And although Jerry Goldsmith did not win an Oscar for it, the film did take home 7 statues, including Best Actor, Best Director, and Best Picture. So, why did you want to talk about Patton?
Well, I wanted to talk about Patton for a number of reasons. I think it's it demonstrates... Let me give you some background. I had this conversation with Warren Etheridge today about filmmakers and composers, and how... filmmakers kind of come out of film school. It's almost with very little idea of what music does in a film. So they're coming out of school, and to me, the attitude has kind of been, you know, if your movie requires music, it's probably not a very good movie. You know, there's probably something with your editing or something wrong with your story, you know, your story yeah. or something like that. You know, I think there's some film purists that really believe that music's just kind of a cheap trick. You know, mm-hmm. your actors aren't doing their job, so you have to add emotion or something. Mm-hmm. And I found when I went through this workshop last year that it was interesting that it wasn't connected to anything from the DGA or anything from, you know, the Writers Guild or anything. Mm-hmm. It was kind of its own separate thing. And I asked the, you know, Richard Bellis is the guy that facilitates the workshop. And he said that, you know, they weren't really interested. It's kind of like this thing that's, you know... It is what it is. And a lot of it coming out of film school with no idea what a composer does or how
yeah.
how a composer works or what a composer can add or what how to pick a good composer, how to understand what the difference is between good film music and bad music.
Right.
Because there's so much now that there's a lot of, you know, it's obvious to me that either the studio executives or the filmmakers don't really understand the craft, because it's, you know.
Well, a lot of it's right now seems like needle drop. Like some, especially indie films, it just feels like I need a mood. And so it's like, here's some sad guitar.
And even if it's composed, it's kind of through composed. It's wallpaper. Yeah, they're not following the drama. They're not paying attention to the dialogue, how the guitars are fighting with the frequency of the male voice, mm-hmm. if he's talking or whatever. And so becomes, you know, the solution is to turn down the music.
Right. Well, one of the things I noticed about watching Patton again is there is a theme that runs through this movie. And it's actually, I think, you know, we were joking about it before, like this, like, you know, and it's like, I think it's actually a theme that a lot of people probably are really familiar with, and they probably don't even realize the source is from this movie.
Exactly. This theme plays at Disneyland in certain sections or dedicated. Soaring Over California is complete, you know, all Patton almost.
Wait, what is
The ride Soaring Over California?
Really?
Yeah. So it's, you walk in and they're playing Patton, you know, because it's kind of this Americana aviation, even though it's not aviation, but it's not, kind of like, it's got a martial thing. It's got a militaristic thing,
right.
You know, along with the American president, and there's some other stuff in there.
Yeah.
But it's a lot of Jerry Goldsmith and his Patton. And and that's the first thing I think that a composer does, is he knows the idioms. So I had a conversation with Brian McDonald, and I love his books as a layperson and not being a writer.
Yeah.
They reduce narrative structure and thing to very clearly, and they explain it very clearly, and it's this thing that you can talk about. Music, on the other hand, is a challenge to talk about. It's,
yes.
And so Brian, I was playing one of the pieces for Brian, and Brian was saying, you know, it sounds so right. Why does it sound right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, I'm working within an idiom. These harmonies fit what this piece of music was supposed to serve. And there was no easy way to explain it without talking about mediant motion or suspended fourth chords, or, you know, it's all very musical vocabulary that it's, if you don't know it, it's very like esoteric and weird, you know?
Yeah.
And so, that's the one thing a good composer does, is he understands intuitively, idioms. And the thing about Patton is that theme, that specific theme, is very idiomatic, right? It's the same style as, let's say, The Bridge Over the River Kwai, or even something like Hogan's Heroes.
Mm-hmm.
There's a style that's like that World War II American or British militaristic. It's kind of like fife and drum corps, but more modern.
Yeah.
And he's using that idiom and writing within it. He's not violating the laws of that idiom, right? It's a language he knows, right? And it's a language he understands, and it's mastered. And to have somebody write that doesn't quite know the idiom or is kind of trying to fake it, it doesn't really work, right? So the first thing a composer does is understand the idioms, and there's tons of them, right? There's stuff that's animation is an idiom, you know, animation music, and stuff like, you know, How to Train Your Dragon is completely different than Bugs Bunny. That's another idiom, you know?
Right.
And so there are languages that they're built up over time, that we build up over time, that we agree do a certain thing, or we agree are good.
Right.
Right. And to not know those languages, is like somebody trying to write a book in Spanish without learning the novel.
Yeah.
Do you know? Or not learning the language first, not learning the basic vocabulary and mastering that, and then becoming an art, and then expanding on it, right? Right.
Yeah. Let's take a listen to the theme. We'll be right back.
So what Patton does, I think, so brilliantly, and what it illustrates is that in that main title, there are three idioms that are happening, and it gets very, very, it gets complex. So the character of Patton, right, is, first of all, he's a very good Christian man. Mm-hmm. He's an American Christian who goes to church every Sunday, kneels down, prays to Yahweh and Jesus, right?
Yeah.
And sings hymns, right?
Right, yeah.
So one of the idioms within that main title is it's almost like a Lutheran hymn. Right, it's played on organ, and it's in the background, and it kind of it comes in. So first you have those echoing trumpets,
right,
and then the organ comes in playing. It's a hymn, right? And the other side to Patton's character is the kind of pagan warrior who believes in reincarnation, who believes he was fought on battlefields 1500 years ago.
Right.
Those echoing trumpets are, that's what those represent.
Yeah, yeah.
And so what you have, and they're, I don't want to use musician terms, but it's polytonal. So the trumpets are playing in one key, and the organ is playing in another key, right? Charles Ives used to do it. It was a very famous piece where he had, you know, a simulation of two marching bands marching, and then they merge in the middle and they're playing in different keys, and then they go their separate ways.
Okay.
So he, and what it does is create this dissonance between the kind of Lutheranish hymn and these echoey kind of pagan trumpets in different keys. And it creates this dissonance that describes perfectly the character, that kind of dissonance in Patton. Right. Cause no, you know, Jesus is going to look at you askew if you start talking about, you know, reincarnation and,
right,
and being a warrior 1500 years ago. So those, it's first he understands the idioms, and the echoing trumpets are something that I've heard in a number of Jerry Goldsmith scores. So like, that kind of stylistic thing, using, I think it was probably a tape echo. I forget what year this was. It was 70.
Yeah. So 69 when they made it.
69 probably. When you made it. So, yeah. So, and Planet of the Apes is probably 68 or something. 67.
That was released, I think, 68 or 69. 69, I think.
So it's probably a tape echo machine.
Yeah.
And, it's the way he would do sci-fi, and it directly, especially Planet of the Apes, you can hear, it's an idiom. It's the Twilight Zone. It's TV music. It's sci-fi TV music from the 50s and 60s. It was a whole language used then that has become, you know, since obsolete and kind of anachronistic.
Sure.
You don't want to, if you evoke that, it's in a, you know, it's in a period piece or a Michael Giacchino score where he's doing the Twilight Zone.
Mm-hmm.
So he understands these idioms so well. The, and that kind of echoplex thing is the way that those composers kind of describe either, like, you know, kind of a weird, creepy spiritual thing or a weird, creepy kind of supernatural thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like reincarnation. So he's combining these two idioms in this beautiful way. And then after that, it turns into this kind of martial march that again is that idiom from the Bridge on the River Kwai or Hogan's Heroes or whatever.
Right.
So there's these three idioms at play. And just in that main title, which is, and it's this one big kind of arc. It starts with the trumpets, the organ comes in, it goes into the martial music, then it fades back into, you know, the trumpets and the organ, and then it ends with the trumpets again. It's this beautiful kind of like arc. And the entire language for the movie is contained within that, whatever it is, 3 minutes, really a minute 30 seconds, because he just starts taking away material after that.
Right.
You know, it's just becomes, let's pull stuff away.
Right.
So within a minute and 30 seconds, he does three idioms beautifully, contrasts to that create or describe musically the dissonance in this character. And then goes into like, kind of like an idiomatic World War II march, and then that's the entire language for the movie. He's got everything he needs in that minute and 30 seconds. From then on, it's just like, let's put this theme in this context, let's put this theme in the context, let's put the trumpets here, let's bring the organ in here, let's, you know, do a little snare drum march here. Mm-hmm. The entire language is described in a minute and 30 seconds. It's absolutely brilliant.
That's pretty awesome. Like, I mean, I subconsciously was picking up on that when I was watching it, but to hear it explained like that, I can totally see it now.
That's why it's so exciting. And that's why people, Jerry Goldsmith is very, he's, you know, people are always like John Williams, Jerry Goldsmith, but Jerry Goldsmith's always kind of the dark horse. He's a little more mysterious. Mm-hmm. People don't understand what he's doing a lot, why people think he's a genius.
Yeah.
But this score really, really shows kind of it's three-dimensional chess. You know, mm-hmm. he's really brilliant in describing the drama and creating the character, in knowing and it's the other thing he really does well is that it's all built on this rock solid musical foundation. So he understands the orchestra. He understands how to get the sounds out of the orchestra and make it musical or violent or dissonant, or he understands it. So when he does an idiom like the that's the other thing, when he does the idioms, they're the best they've ever been done. They're not only he has not only mastered the language, but he does it to such a high degree. And then he always and this is where genius comes in, I think, to film composers and composers in general. He adds to the language, whether it's small or large, he expands it. So things like, you know, there are revolutionary pieces like The Rite of Spring or American Beauty, even Edward Scissorhands. Edward Scissorhands actually defined Christmas music for the past 15 years.
It did, yeah.
It really did.
Yeah.
American Beauty did the same thing for corporate music.
Okay, yeah.
Brian Eno, music for airports. People still use... if you're a film composer, you either come from the Brian Eno school or the John Williams school.
Yeah, right.
It's an exaggeration, but it's kind of like that. You know what I mean? You're either like alt-indie soundscape or you're orchestral... classically trained, you know.
How do you see yourself?
I come from a rock background, but I've spent the past 10 years mastering the orchestra.
Yeah.
So it's something that I really wanted to do. So my heart lies closer, I think, to the orchestral stuff. But, you know, I'm called upon all the time to do, you know, I'm a guitar player to start with,
yeah,
so I have, you know, I have that capability and
swing
tons
both
of
ways.
I swing both ways. In other words, thanks, Kris.
Yeah. All right. Well, we need to take a little break, but when we come back, we'll talk a little bit about some of the scenes where I think the music really works beautifully, and then we'll talk a little bit more about Jerry Goldsmith.
Great. So,
our sponsor today is a movie called Inheritance. Have you ever heard of that, Eric?
Excellent movie.
When old Mrs. Baker died, Abby inherited more than just her house. A young woman believes that the spirit of her dead benefactress is inhabiting her body, but her friends think that her family's history of schizophrenia has finally caught up with her. Available at Vimeo.com on demand. Inheritance, a Kris Kristensen film.
Arab women. Stripped them of their tunics and their swords and lances. The soldiers lay naked in the sun. 2,000 years ago. I was here. You don't believe me, do you, Brad?
This is a movie it's almost 3 hours long.
Right.
There's probably like 30 minutes of music in it, tops.
It's very interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's got a lot of big battle scenes. There's no music in any of the battle scenes, except towards the end, and it's not even really a battle scene, it's almost like a montage of their advancing into France and pushing the Germans back and
oh yeah, and it's just kind of it is
music,
a montage though.
Yeah, it's music and we don't hear any sound effects, and so we're seeing, you know, it's a nice contrast because it's the music is just sort of atmospheric at that point, but you know there's all this violence happening on the screen. But like, you know, I think that's another thing is you kind of think your expectations, it's like, oh, it's a war movie, so it's going to have a lot of like music, you know, to, you know, punctuate the explosions and stuff. There's none. None whatsoever.
Yeah, and as far as a war movie, there's not a lot of combat, right?
No, there's
it's,
not.
It's more of a... I mean, it to me, it says... The composer and the director are supremely confident, right? They
yeah.
know it's they know they don't need to overwrite. You know, they have the it's the same thing Goldsmith did on Chinatown. There's very little music, but what music it is, it's perfectly placed. It's perfectly written. It perfectly right. complements the scenes that need to be complemented. Bernard Herrmann was known for that as well. Like picking places that are maybe not intuitive to start and stop music, but are brilliant after you step away and watch actually what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
There's I always go back to that scene in Indiana Jones where they're in the Tibetan bar.
Oh, wow.
And the German is holding the
hot poker.
The hot poker to yeah. her face, and there's all this tense music.
Yeah.
And then Indiana Jones is like, let her go, and the music gets tenser. And then the music stops, and then the fight starts. And the entire fight has got
oh, right.
no
yeah.
music.
Yeah.
And it's you know, it makes sense that you wouldn't have music during a fight scene because you have sound effects, you mm-hmm. have crazy editing, you have you don't, you know, unless you know, and the music will just be, it's going to be a problem. You're going to be fighting sound effects, you're going to be fighting all these things. And if, you know, that could be one example where if, you know, if you have music in your fight scene and your battle scene, maybe there's something wrong with your battle scene.
Well, it's, who knows? It's something that I think you see a lot regardless of the fact, I mean, what you say makes total sense. But I also think it's one of those things where, like when I first started working in the biz, I worked for some sound effects editors. And there was a lot of, or no, I'm sorry, they were music editors. And this was just like the classic argument you would see every time you'd get to the mixing stage. It would be like, you know, the composer was upset at all the sound effects that the sound designer had put in. The sound designer was upset that there was music underneath all of his sound effects. And it was just, and it was this constant, just this screaming match. These two teams like hated each other. They just hated each other. And, you know, and the director was kind of sitting in the middle, like not sure what to do most of the time.
Let's talk about craft for a little bit. So this is another thing Jerry Goldsmith was a master at. Okay. And sometimes it's unavoidable that there are going to be clashes like that, because a lot of the times the work copy the composer's working off of doesn't have the sound effects on it. So he doesn't really know. He has to sure. guess. So if yeah. there's a big explosion, he's like, all right, I should probably not hit the Gran Casa there and the Piatti right on the beat. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Cause there's going to be a sound effect there. Other yeah. times it's not so obvious. So what Jerry Goldsmith, and this goes back to craft of film composing, in addition to knowing the idioms, in addition to having mastered the instruments you're writing for. So a lot of times now I hear indie rock guys writing for a flute or orchestral instruments or strings, and they don't really know how to voice them, or they don't know what ranges to put them in. They don't know where the beautiful range is. They don't know how to get what they want out of an instrument. So it kind of sounds, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but it tends to sound kind of quirky and, you know, to my ear, kind of not right, you know? Mm-hmm. The other thing, so in addition to mastering the instruments, in addition to mastering the idioms, there's things like dialogue. There are things like sound effects. There are things like music spotting, like where you put the music. So a good composer is going to know, is going to understand, let's say there's a male character speaking. He's going to understand where that frequency range is.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to stay out of that frequency range.
Okay, sure.
Because then you can have the music and the voice, and you don't have to turn down one or the other. There's
right.
no fight.
Right.
So a lot of craft of film scoring is that kind of like understanding the idiom, knowing that you treat that dialogue, you treat that monologue, you treat that person speaking as a solo instrument,
mm-hmm.
right? You stay out of its way. So the dubbing mixer doesn't have to do anything. He just leaves the faders up and he's like my job's easy. Right. That's the way it should be, right?
Yeah,
you should,
yeah.
Same thing with sound effects. So if you know, if you have a work copy, pay attention, that has the sound effects in, pay attention to where the sound effects are. You know, you work around them. It's music. You're working around gunshots. You're working around explosions. You're working around punches. You're working around those things that are, you know, you're part of a whole. You know, sound effects, you know, if the sound effects guy's like, I want my sound effects, and the music guy's like, they're not working for the project. They're working for some other reason, you know, whether it's ego or like my vision or whatever. It's the director's vision you're serving. It's the story. It's the narrative. So the thing that ultimately it comes down to is what serves the narrative. You know, if hearing the punch at that point serves the narrative, then you need to get out of the way of that, that sound as a composer. And a lot of, you know, in a lot of indie film, they don't understand, you just don't know how to do it.
Yeah. So speaking of sound effects, Jerry Goldsmith, in addition to Patton, he's done Planet of the Apes, Alien, Basic Instinct, he did Chinatown. I mean,
the list goes on.
I mean, it's crazy. I mean, seriously, look him up on IMDb if you've never heard of him. He probably has 100 movies and you've probably heard of most of them. And in fact, one of the episodes we just talked about was Lonely Are the Brave, Kirk Douglas movie. And I think it was Goldsmith's first score that he did.
Oh, yeah. I think
a modern Western. I think, late 50s, maybe, or maybe it was 62. 60, I forget.
Right.
Yeah.
Early 60s.
Yeah. But the point I was getting at is that a lot of his stuff, like especially with Planet of the Apes, it's very like, it sounds like bamboo sticks slapping together and stuff like that. And it's just, it goes beyond the soundtrack. Like it feels like it's part of the sound effect in a way.
Well, this is where, expanding lines. You know, I talked about he knows the idioms so well. He'd mastered every idiom he needs to master. Then he starts expanding them. And then he starts inventing. He adds on to the language.
Mm-hmm.
So on Planet of the Apes, he's got stuff like overturned salad bowls. He's got stuff like a crumb horn, which is just like an ancient horn. Like, I saw the Hunt, which is a piece off Planet of the Apes performed live by the LA Phil about a year and a half ago. And it was the most visceral. It was unbelievable how savage it was.
Oh, I bet, yeah.
It was incredible to see that piece live with those players in that hall. It was an experience. And the conductor was interesting. It was a guest conductor, and he said, like, this may be one of the only original film scores. And I don't think he was right, because he was writing within that in idiom that was, you know, was composers knew that style. Where he made his contributions was taking it to such a high level. I can do music geek talk here for a second.
Go right ahead.
the score is pontilistic, so there's never many. There's no notes happening at the same time. Vertically, right? Mm-hmm. Everything's like a line. So the flute's playing a line, or the pizzicato strings are playing a line, and it's all kind of like just little points in the air over time.
Yeah.
Right? And it's also like Hollywood, what they called Hollywood 12 tone. So it's like, Schoenberg's style of manipulating notes, which is completely artificial, and then kind of dumbed down a little bit so they can make it dramatic. So it's a style that was very well known, and there's stuff in there. You know, I hear, you go back to Planet of the Apes, I hear John Williams ripping stuff off in Star Wars 10 years later.
Mm.
I hear stuff that he, you know,
yeah.
Oh, it's just that style.
Yeah.
But Goldsmith adding things like salad bowls, or Goldsmith adding things like crumb horn, and then doing the idiom at such a ridiculously high level, so musical or so savage or whatever, is really what distinguishes him from most of composers in history. That's why people mention those two guys is it.
Is he like one of your inspirations? Is he your guy?
He's one of my inspirations. He's interesting. Like he's I would describe him as gamier than John Williams.
Gamier?
Yeah. So he writes stuff that's not as commercially as appealing. He takes more risks.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, I was thinking about that on as I was getting ready for this. You know, it's like, I mean, Williams, he probably has a half dozen scores that you could whistle and people would go like, oh, that's Close Encounters, that's Jaws, that's Star Wars, that's Empire Strikes Back.
Right.
Whereas I think, as what I was saying with Patton, it's like I know people have heard this score, but they probably don't know where it comes from.
They think it's Yankee Doodle Dandy or something. Right. Some folk song from wherever, that's what it sounds like.
Yeah, you know, and likewise, all of his stuff, it's like it's stuff that you've heard before, but I mean, it really is, like, I mean, I grew up listening to the Alien soundtrack. I still have the LP.
And
it's just this atmospheric, like, ooh, you know, like, it sounds like somebody blowing into a beer bottle at points. And
right.
It's just trippy shit. And it's just, but it's amazing stuff. And it certainly sets the mood and sets a tone. But somehow he's able, I think what's kind of amazing about it, especially like I think of that scene in Planet of the Apes where they're about to catch Charlton Heston, you know, and they're running through cornfields. The first time you see that, realize that you're on a planet of apes.
Right.
and it's like, what the hell? It's like, it's an ape riding a horseback. But I just remember them running through the fields, and it's like, it just feels so staccato. There's so much punctuation going on. And it's like the fact that he's able to kind of compose something that is, at the one point you can listen to it on a record and it sounds like a piece of music, but at the same time it seems like it's so perfectly constructed just to like hit on almost on edits.
That's another trick that really good composers can pull off, is they can write music for a scene, they can write incidental music, and then you play it away from the scene and it still works as a piece of music. A lot of times it's not, you know, it's not possible, and a lot of that stuff gets left off, let's say, you know, film CDs of film scores.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, if you can write a piece of music that does something for the scene and follows the dramatic arc and brings all the kind of, like, it's almost coloration, you know, like the, mm-hmm. in the post, it just brings out the hues a little bit more and makes it, you know, brings out the magic. And have that piece work as a standalone piece. I mean, it's harder than it seems, you know, and a lot of people can't do it.
It's incredible what music does.
It really is. I'm a fan.
Yeah. and you're good at it too. So, I mean, it's always interesting to see somebody that like knows what they're doing. One of my favorite moments in Patton, the German army is starting to advance, and we hear like this low rumbling music. Maybe it's timpani drums or something. Not sure what the instrument is, but
in the desert when the tanks are coming? Or
it's right before the tanks are coming, and Patton is asleep, and his butler comes in to wake him and tell him, you know, that the Germans are advancing, and so the butler helps him get dressed, and you know, we hear the themes that we've heard, but we don't hear those echoing horns yet. And then it cuts back and forth between the Germans, so it cuts to like the rumbling, and then it cuts back to him getting dressed. And he's almost dressed now. He's standing in the mirror. He's put on his gun. And his butler comes up behind him with his helmet, and he places the helmet on his head like a crown almost. And just at that moment, as he's putting that on his head, you hear the... It was just like, oh my God, that's such... That's what I'm talking about. It's like, just like to know, like to save that horn for that moment where it's suddenly like, it's like Caesar being, you know, brought back to life. You know, this reincarnation theme that's going on.
I just got chills, you know, and I remember as a kid seeing the movie and getting chills when they're surveying the ancient battlefield and the horns are playing and he's talking about reincarnation.
Yeah.
I was here.
Yeah.
And you know, he really believed it.
And it's great too, because they set it up there. He's driving around with Carl Malden.
Right.
And he's like, the battlefield's over here. And Malden's like, no, I think it's the other way. He's like, no, it's over here. And then he like makes him pull over. And then he goes over to this ancient ruins where there's nothing.
Right.
And then he starts talking about this, like, you know, it's like, this is where we were 2,000 years ago. And that's when you start to realize, oh, this dude's into reincarnation. And you'd believe it. And it's a great scene.
It's an amazing scene.
Well, thank you for joining us. Are you on Twitter? Are you?
I am on. I should really get on Twitter. I'm trying to get better at the social networking thing. I'm on Facebook. I'm on LinkedIn. I should start my Twitter account. All right. Anyway, visit me on my website.
Okay.
It's just erikaho.com. Send me an email.
And it's E-R-I-K-A-H-O.
A-H-O.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to hear from you. Love to hear about your projects. Whatever.
Cool.
Would enjoy meeting you.
And you can hear Eric's latest work in Oil and Water, which screens June 3rd at 7 p.m. and June 4th at 4:15 p.m. Both screenings are going to be at the AMC Pacific Place 11. And you can get your tickets at the box office, but do yourself a favor and lock that up by going to SIFF.net, where you can order your tickets. And again, I'd like to thank our sponsor for the movie Inheritance, available now on video on demand at Vimeo. Inheritance, ask for it by name. And until next time, remember, it's never too late to start thinking about the past.